Actually, I've got a whole heap of notes and I think I'm going to ignore them because as I've been listening, I want to change a bit of the focus of what I want to talk. So I'm going to skim through some stuff and I apologise for that. And we might just have to have conversations later if there's things that you don't quite understand that I've skimmed through, because I want to get to the guts of it, which is a bit later on. But first of all, we talk a lot about passion and passion of wreck fishers and passion of the scientists. And what I'd really like to sort of put out there is my boss, because she's my boss. but also, Helena is just one of the most passionate people for native fish that I've ever come across. And I'm just staggered by what she does. I'm staggered by how enthusiastic she is. Katie's not much different. She's incredibly passionate about it. And I'm slowly getting the bug myself. So it's great. Just don't forget that even though we work for the NWBA or the Commonwealth Government, we are really passionate about what we do as well. So please don't forget that. And we are trying to do our best. Oh. So this is some of these early slides of what I'm going to try and race through. I think we all understand there's a huge need for water reform. We've been increasing irrigation diversions from hundreds of years ago, well, 150, 160 odd years ago. And when we hit the 2000s, we really started to try and reduce that. And the latest step in that path is the Basin Plan and the Water Act. And obviously it's a key part of the water reform agenda. The Water Act, Basin Plan. The Basin Plan is talking about more water for the environment and better use of that water. So the huge benefits for native fish is because water affects every single stage of that life cycle, obviously. So the Basin Plan has plenty of opportunities to actually improve native fish. And we try and do that through this basin-wide environmental watering strategy. And it's got a bunch of sort of environmental outcomes that we want to achieve with basin-wide watering. It's got strategies for using it and how we manage it, and an approach that we use for sort of prioritising annually. But this is where the real interest is for people who care about native fish. And I can tell you a hell of a lot of the outcomes in here relate very closely to the stuff that we talked about in the native fish strategy. And again, it's part of that legacy of the native fish strategy, and that is conveyed through this BWS strategy. And that's in no small part, again, to Helena. And of course, all the networks that we had from the NFS. So when we're trying to implement the basin-wide watering strategy and annual watering strategies, it's difficult. We've got things, we've got dams, we've got weirs, we've got unregulated scenarios, we've got different scenarios that are happening in different catchments. You've got basin-wide strategy like we have. We've got basin-wide priorities, which are sort of more the annual expression of that strategy. You've got long-term watering plans, you've got water sharing plans, you've got regional priorities, and then you've actually got to deliver on those priorities. And then there's agriculture, there's Aboriginal needs, there's the social needs, there's other things in the river, apparently, other sort of biota. I don't know anything about it. And then you get to fish, and you've got guys who don't like, well, they need flow, but they don't necessarily respond to it. You've got a bunch of guys who respond strongly to flow. You've got guys who maybe like slower water and, you know, not necessarily. And then you've got little guys as well. And all that says to me is that when you try, and this is the work that Ian Ellis, Kat Cheshire, and Tony did in the north, we're trying to get this conceptual hydrograph that will sort of try to meet all the fish needs, all the different groups, all the different life history stages. This is what we're dealing with, and we're dealing with this at the basin scale. So it's huge, and it gives me a headache pretty much every day, but that's okay. But what we in the environmental water planning team, Helena, myself, others, is we're trying to build on what the science is telling us and incorporate it in that water planning. So, I forgot to start my stopwatch, but that's okay. So science is telling us, and you've heard it today, you've probably heard it before today, you'll hear it again afterwards. Connectivity is important. Productivity is important. Flow to maintain habitat, base flows in winter and other times of the year, that's important. This is all about recruitment and ensuring genuine recruitment and population recovery. The Lower Darling, Mid Murray and the Lower Murray are all sort of interlinked and they're all important. And it's those interactions are important to sort of maintain. And we've talked about dispersal and its importance for, for golden and silver perch. And so we're trying to capture all that science and include it in how we shape our environmental watering priorities. And this year, I think we've done a great job in trying to incorporate some of this very latest science. So Zeb's stuff that he talked about this morning, I think we got the draft report, I don't know when, April, May. We usually publish our priorities on the 30th of June. And so we have tried to incorporate those findings into the priorities and really lift the prioritisation that, you know, these silver perch need annual flows because their life expectancy in that mid-Murray is so much shorter than we expected. So we're trying to grab that science, immediately try and put it into our water planning. And similarly, Wayne's work on the dispersal of goldens and silvers and the juveniles, we're trying to incorporate that, plus all the other stuff that's going on. We've talked about lamprey, in the annual priorities this year as well. And we're already seeing the benefits of that, and it's only August, which is fantastic. There's also been some other changes, and some of these are long-term, not necessarily in response to the science, but this is a good sign. We're heading in the right direction. So in the Southern Basin, there's actually coordinating mechanisms. There's a coordinating committee that tries to coordinate all the environmental water holders in that Southern Basin so that we can deliver with maximum efficiency and maximum benefit. We've got a bunch of water and land managers that are now starting to think outside their patch. They used to think about sort of catchments and maybe a spawning flow in the Goulburn to try and increase populations in the Goulburn. The science is telling us that's important, but the system scale and there's other benefits in other locations that actually can produce the outcome you're looking for in your patch, but it might be happening somewhere else, as Charles just sort of demonstrated. As I say, we're trying to reflect all those science needs in environmental watering priorities, and people are actively delivering water to try and meet these needs. So I can't remember how many people were involved in arranging those flows in the Goulburn and Campaspe sort of in late autumn this year, trying to get silver perch and golden perch up those tributaries. Like someone was talking about yesterday, hell of a lot of home calls, hell of a lot of coordination, hell of a lot of people involved, but it's driven by this system scale connectivity and system scale understanding, and that's really, really important. And we're starting to get that, and we're getting that message across, which is fantastic. Gets me out of bed in the morning. What's the time, Tony? 9 minutes to go, excellent. Oh, no. So a big ticket item for Helena and myself and other people in the team, if we can get them, and they stay, Beatrix, leaving. No, that's not her fault. Is about connected flow planning. So we're trying to build, again, that system scale connectivity into flow planning. So it's about connecting the River Murray, the Darling River, all the tributaries with flows that actually support that system scale population recovery. So we're trying to describe, this is the stuff that Clayton was talking about yesterday. We've got a Southern Connected Flow Plan. It's about describing what those system scale connectivity needs are. We're trying to promote what the actions and opportunities that can be done to actually lead to major outcomes. And before that thing's even published, because of the conversations that we're having, there's stuff happening on ground already. People can't get this stuff fast enough. And so what that is about is trying to, we've talked about these recruitment zones that are hugely important in system scale connectivity. And so we're trying to make recruitment happen in these zones with flows, but then also backing that up with the flows that encourage the dispersal to the tributaries to the lower Murray as per the sort of natural system, and follow that up. So we're not just talking about spawning anymore, we're talking about the whole life cycle. And so we're trying to embed this sort of stuff. This was actually in the annual watering priorities this year. We want to talk about flows to encourage lamprey out the upstream as well. Really important stuff. And now we're trying to get this sort of thinking starting and developing it in the north. We've talked about, Sam talked about the connectivity for golden perch. We want to see more of that. And as Charles and John and others have shown, we can have basin-wide outcomes by thinking at the basin scale and making sure that flows and connectivity are all happening and there's little pieces of the puzzle that stitch together and make a big impact. A lot of people ask me about the little guys. We haven't done as much work on it, but we've got a concept in mind, and it's about sort of, we have these isolated populations at the moment, and we know that, and the threatened species priority that we published this year talks about trying to build the populations in these sites to give us a population that we can use to either, a bit in code, either translocate or that can move naturally to other suitable habitats, and ideally over time build this sort of system where we're getting beyond the isolated populations and they're able to connect either through our active interventions. We need to water sites to prepare them for fish. It's a long story. That's going to take decades. We're under no illusions about that. I'm going to have to skim over this, but basically this is where we're trying to get. We're trying to get fish science into every aspect of the water planning. So we can very easily get it into the environmental watering strategy and environmental watering priorities, because that's what we do, but we're also trying to influence these other areas and making sure that science and that later science and understanding that comes from monitoring and comes especially from research like Brenton was talking about into those plans. And we're getting a heap of actions which I can't even talk about because I'm running out of time, but things are happening, things have happened in the past 12 months which are fantastic and really exciting. And everyone's talked about those. Katie's here, I've got to talk about the evaluation because I'm an DBA employee, but I need notes. We're not just using the science in developing the flow planning, we're actually using it in the evaluation. We're using it to guide what we actually expect to have happened 5 years after Basin Plan implementation, and a long way to go before we're even at full implementation. There's only certain things we can expect to have changed, and science has really sort of helped us inform what those things might be. And we're also using it to interpret the findings and the results we get. So we've got a basin-wide survey of native fish, standard methods. It's like the old SRA survey. It's giving us some awesome data now. So these are golden perch populations, and you can see, oh God, that's blurry as hell. But basically there is northern populations have a certain structure. Southern populations have a different structure. But in 2010-11, those structures kind of merged. And the science is telling us that, this is backing up, and the science actually informs how these populations are different, but when we have full scale, system scale connectivity, these population structures actually merge because we're getting juveniles and small fish actually moving throughout the whole system and making those population structures more even and more standard between the north and the south. Similarly for trout cod, we're able to sort of, the science is telling us that these things are actually recovering and that, I'm stuffing this up, I'm sorry, Katie. I can't even find it on there. But again, science is kind of helping us interpret. Jeez, that cold is nasty, mate. Really, too much booze last night. But we're using that science to interpret the results and come up with recommendations, and that's all part of the evaluation. Stay tuned, there's some interesting stuff from the evaluation, even though it is really early days for the Basin Plan. And finally, something that we also wanted to bring up is the science will only get us so far, I think, in influencing a lot of these matters. And this is where you guys all come in. By becoming informed, finding out, attending these things, getting chances to show how passionate you are about native fish and native fishing and recreational fishing, and then getting in people's ear and having a say about it. So talking to local members, writing annoying letters, all that sort of stuff, getting involved in the planning processes where you can is really important, because in the end, it's not a scientific process, it's a bit of political process as well, and this is where you guys can really influence. So thank you very much.